نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. The religion of Islam is the most valued commodity in the life of every believer. And preservation of the religion from the many forms of moral and spiritual perversion and corruption should be top priority over all other personal and secular endeavors. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم قل إن كان آباؤكم وأبناؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم أزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمره والله لا يهدي القوم الفاسقين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that indeed if your fathers and your children and your brothers and your wives or your spouses in reference to the wife, your husbands or your tribes or your wealth which you fear a loss in it or your residencies which you fear, which you love so dearly are more beloved to you than Allah and His Messenger and fighting and struggling in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَتَرَبَّصُوا, then just wait until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about His affair. And Allah does not guide a people who are fasiqeen, who are evil, rebellious, sinful, disobedient Muslims. قال العلماء رحمهم الله تعالى أن مقصود الشرع من الخلق خمسة. That the objective of the legislation of Al-Islam in reference to the human being are five. وَهُوَ أَنْ يَحْفَظْ عَلَيْهِمْ دِينَهُمْ وَنَفْسَهُمْ وَعَقْلَهُمْ وَنَسْلَهُمْ وَمَالَهُمْ فَكُلَّمَا يَتَضَمَّنُ حِفْظَ هَذِهِ الْأُصُولِ الْخَمْسَةِ فَهُوَ مَصْلَحَةٌ وَكُلَّمَا يَفُوتُ هَذِهِ الْأُصُولِ فهو مفسدة ودفعها مصلحة. انتهى كلامهم رحمهم الله تعالى. That the objectives of the legislation about Islam, meaning all that what we have in Islam of halal and haram, are centered around preserving five things. And so the fuqaha of Islam, the scholars of jurisprudence, they are known as the dururiyat al-khams, the five basic needs of every believer. And that is the number one, to preserve deenum, to preserve your deen. Everything that we have in Islam of halal and haram, yajuz, ma yajuz, permissible, not permissible, allowed, not allowed, are centered around preserving five things. At the top of those five is your deen. Deenum, preservation, nafsum, is to preserve your souls, your bodies, yourselves. Aqluhum, to preserve your intellect. Wamalahum, and to preserve your wealth. Wanasluhum, and to preserve your lineage. And anything that entails preservation of these five things is considered in Islam a maslaha, a benefit. And anything that causes us to forfeit, or any forfeiture of any one of these five things, is considered a mafsada, is considered a detriment. And repelling any detriment is in fact considered a maslaha, is considered a benefit. And notice how the sequence of these things, these five important matters, at the top of these things was the religion. Preservation of the deen, brothers and sisters, is top priority to Islam. Unfortunately, it is not top priority to many Muslims. قال الشاعر رحمه الله تعالى إذا أبقيت الدنيا على المرء دينه فما فاته منها فليس بضائر فلا تزن الدنيا جناح بعوضة ولا وزن رق من جناح لطائر فلم يرضى بالدنيا ثواب لمحسن ولا رضي الدنيا عقاب للكافر. The poet, he said that if you lose all of the dunya, إِذَا أُقِيَتِ الدُّنْيَا عَلَى الْمَرْءِ دِينُهُ فَمَا فَاتَهُ مِنْهَا فَلَيْسَ بِضَائِرٍ يَعْنِي لَا يَدُرُّ. that if the individual lose everything from this dunya, but his deen remains intact, then what he lost from the dunya will not harm him in the least. The dunya, the same dunya that we go after so diligently, so vigilantly, that if you lose all of the dunya, but you still have your deen, then what you lost from the dunya will not harm you in the least. The dunya, in comparison to the wing of a gnat, is not even, it doesn't weigh anything. As well as the feathers on the wing of a bird. The muhsin, the good doer in this life, would not be pleased with all of the dunya as a reward for his good, nor would the dunya itself be satisfied as a punishment for the disbeliever. No matter how hard his life is in this life, the worst type of punishment in this life would not suffice as a sufficient punishment for a kafir. It has to be the hellfire. That is the only sufficient punishment for a disbeliever. The corruption of our deen, brothers and sisters, it emerges from two very subtle, destructive entities, which most people don't place much emphasis on, which is why very, very few have control over these things. The tongue and the private part. The corruption of our deen comes from two areas that most people don't put enough emphasis on, so as a result of that, they have very little control over them. And that is the tongue and the private part. Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentions in his Sahih on the authority of Sahal ibn Sa'id al-Sa'id, قَالَ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ أَضْمَنْ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لِحْلَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ فَخِذَيْهِ أَضْمَنْ لَهُ وَالْجَنَّةِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever can guarantee me what is between his two lips and between his two thighs, I can guarantee you paradise. If you can guarantee me control over what is between your lips and what is between your legs, I can guarantee you paradise. قال ابن بطال رحمه الله تعالى دل الحديث على أن أعظم البلاء على المرء في الدنيا لسانه وفرجه فمن وقي شرهما وقي أعظم الشر ومن أدى الحق الذي على لسانه من النطق بما يجب عليه والصمت عما لا يعنيه وأدى الحق الذي على فرجه من وضعه في الحلال وكفه عن الحرام فله الجنة. Ibn Battal, in his explanation of this hadith, he said this hadith points to the fact that the greatest bala, the greatest trial for the human being is his tongue and his private part. So whoever is saved from the evil of these two body parts, then he has been saved from the greatest trial that can come to any human being. Whoever fulfills the rights of the tongue, and that is by only uttering what is truth, and being silent about things that don't concern you, and fulfilling the right of the private part by putting it in a place that is halal for it, and refraining from putting it in a place that is haram for it, then you will be guaranteed paradise. And the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed so much emphasis on these two is because out of all of the other faculties of the human being, these two are by far the most detrimental to the human being. Because it is through these two that the vast majority of people in the hellfire, they enter through these two areas of the body. The tongue and the private part. On the authority of Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, قَالَ سُئِلَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَنْ أَكْثَرِ مَا يُدْخِلَ النَّاسِ الْجَنَّةِ قَالَ تَقْوَ اللَّهِ وَحُسْنُ الْخُلُقِ وَسُئِلَ عَنْ أَكْثَرِ مَا يُدْخِلَ النَّاسِ النَّارِ فَقَالَ الْفَرْوَ الْفَرْجِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, what are the things that make most people go to paradise? What are the things that cause most people to enter into paradise? He said, taqwallahi wa husnul khuluq. The fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa husnul khuluq and good character. He was asked, and what are the things that cause most people to enter into the hellfire? He said, al-fam wal faraj. Your mouth and your private part. The vast majority of the people that enter into the hellfire is from these two, the mouth and the private part. So much so that Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, he couldn't believe that people will be thrown into the hellfire because of what they say. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, أَوَلْ نَحْنُ مُعَاخَذُونَ بِمَا نَقُولُ قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صلى الله عليه وسلم ثَكِلَتْ يَأُمُّكَ يَا مُعَاذ وَحَلِّكُمْ بِالنَّاسِ عَلَى وُجُوهِهِمْ وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ عَلَى مَنَاخِرِهِمْ فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا السَّبَبِ إِلَّا أَصَائِعَ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. Mu'adh, he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, are you saying that we will be held accountable for what comes out of our mouths? He said, may your mother be bereaved of you, yeah, Mu'adh. He said, is there anything that topples people on their faces into the hellfire? And in another narration, on their necks into the hellfire, except the harvest of their tongue? Is there anything else that causes people to be dragged on their faces in the hellfire, except their tongue? And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us a remedy for these two things. And he said that the vast majority of people who enter into the hellfire is through their mouths and their private parts. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send down this disease, except that he sent down a cure. That's the beauty of our deen. There's a cure for everything. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in an authentic hadith on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من رزقه الله امرأة صالحة فقد أعانه على شطر دينه فليتق الله في الشطر الثاني. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whoever Allah blesses you with a righteous wife, فقد أعانه على شطر دينه, then Allah has assisted you with half of your religion. So fear Allah with the other half of your religion. Gave us a remedy for the two things that cause most people to enter into the hellfire. Al-fam wal-farj, your mouth and your private part. He said, whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him with a righteous wife, فَقَدْ أَعَانَهُ عَلَى شَطْرِ دِينِ, then Allah has assisted you with half of your deen. He's taking care of that half of your deen. فَلْيَتَّقِ اللَّهِ فِي الشَّطْرِ الثَّانِي, so let him fear Allah concerning the other half. وَقَالَ فِي رِوَايَةٍ عِنْدَ الْبَيْحَقِ قال إذا تزوج العبد فقد استكمل نصف الدين فليتق الله في نصف الباقي وحسنه الألباني. It was mentioned in another narration that was collected by Imam al-Bayhaqi. And Imam al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala declared the hadith to be hasan, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that if the servant marries, فقد استكمل نصف الدين, when a servant marries, he has completed half of his deen. So let him fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning the other half. قال إمام القرطبي رحمه الله تعالى معنى ذلك أن النكاح يعفو عن الزنا والعفاف أحد الخصلتين اللتين يضمن أو ضمن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم له الجنة. إمام القرطبي رحمه الله تعالى in his explanation of this hadith, he said that nikah, marriage, it protects the person from zina. Marriage protects you from zina. He said, and it helps to protect the chastity of the individual. And protecting and chastity, al-iffah, chastity is one of those characteristics that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam promised the person that if he could maintain that, that he would enter into paradise. قال إمام الغزالي رحمه الله تعالى وهذا أيضا إشارة إلى فضيلة النكاح لأجل التحرز من المخالفة والتحصن من الفساد. فكان أن المفسد للدين المرء في الأغلب فرجه وبطنه وقد كفى بالتزويج أحدهما. انتهى كلامه رحمه الله تعالى. إمام الغزالي رحمه الله تعالى, he said that this hadith also points to the فضيلة النكاح. It points to the virtue of nikah, the merit of marriage, and that it protects you from violating one of the limits that have been set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to protect you from any type of corruption. And it's as if the corruption of the deen of the individual in most instances is by way of his private part and by way of his no control over his lowly desires. He said, and marriage will suffice you for your private part. Marriage suffices the private part area. قال أبو حاتم الرازي رحمه الله تعالى أن أعظم البلاء القادح في الدين شهوة البطن وشهوة الفرج.
وبالمرأة الصالحة تحصل الإفة عن الزنا وهو الشطر الأول فيلقى الشطر الثاني وهو شهوة البطن فأوصاه صلى الله عليه وسلم بالتقوى فيه لتكمل ديانته وتحصل على الاستقامة. Abu Hakim al-Razi rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that the greatest trial that the human being can be tested with is the desire of his stomach and the desire of his private part. He says, so with the righteous woman, he is able to maintain his chastity and to protect himself from falling into zina, fornication or adultery. And that completes one half of his deen. And the only thing that is left is the second half of his deen, which is the lowly desires. He said, and in that case, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed the servant to have taqwa, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by both of these, fearing Allah and getting married, by both of these, he completes his religiosity. Istakmala diyanatahu, he completes his religiosity. Watahsul ala istiqamah, and you can attain steadfastness in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, brothers and sisters, was very diligent and making sure this area was satisfied with the youth in his community, with the boys in his community. Everything from turning a man's face from the direction of a woman. He was sitting with Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and a woman was walking forward. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam amsaka biwajhihi wa sarrafahu anha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw Ali looking at the woman. He grabbed his face and turned his face the opposite direction. And he said to Ali, Ya Ali, la tutbi'u an-nadhra nadhra, fa inna laka al-ula wa laysa laka al-ukhra. He said to Ali ibn Abi Talib, don't follow up one look with another. He said, because for you is the first look, and the second look is not for you. So encouraging the youth in this community to get married. Today in our communities, we have a dilemma. We have a phenomenon where we're encouraging our children to increase in their knowledge. Not Islamic knowledge, secular knowledge, to get their degree and get married later. But in the process of them getting the degree and them getting married, during that time, how much fasad, how much corruption of their deen have you subjected them to? Our job as parents, brothers and sisters, is not to put our children in a situation where they compromise or jeopardize their deen. Our job as parents is to protect them from that, making deen the top priority, making family top priority, making our lineage top priority. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to instruct the youth in his community, Ya ma'ashara shabab, man istata'a minkum al-ba'a falyatazawwaj, fa'innahu aghaddu lil-basar, wa ahsanu lil-faraj, wa man lam yastati'a fa'alayhi bis-sawm, fa'innahu lahu wija'. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ya ma'ashara shabab, a group of young men, he's addressing the youth in his community. Man istata'a minkum al-ba'a falyatazawwaj. Anyone from amongst you who has the ability to get married, get married. He didn't say wait till you get your degree. He didn't say wait till you finish studying with me and then get married. He said whoever from amongst you have the ability, that's the criteria. Whoever has the ability to get married, then let him do so. فَإِنَّهُ أَغَبُّ لِلْبَصَرِ, because it will help you to lower your gaze. Your degree from the university is not going to help you lower your gaze. وَأَحْصَنُ لِلْفَرَجِ, and will help you protect your private part. Your degree from the university is not going to help you protect your private part. And whoever doesn't have the ability, then let him fast, for indeed that will act as castration for him. قال العلماء وإخراج الحديث مخاطبة الشباب بناء على الغالب لأن أسباب قوة الداعي إلى نكاح فيه موجودة. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he specified the youth in his community with this address simply because it is the youth in the community that have this over enthusiasm as it relates to getting married. This is not something that you find with the elders in the community, and this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that. لا ينظر لا يكلمه لا يكلمه الله يوم القيامة ولا ينظر إليه ولا يزكيه وله عذاب أليم. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said three people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will neither speak to on the day of judgment, nor will He purify them from their sins, nor will He look at them, and for them is a painful punishment. Four things. لا يكلمه لا ينظر إليه ولا يزكيه ولا هو عذاب أليم. Three people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will neither speak to, look at, purify for their sins, nor will, and for them is a painful punishment. The first one, Shaykhun Zani. A Shaykh Zani. The first person he mentioned was an old person who commits zina. Because the older person should understand and should have self-control. Because the characteristic of someone who doesn't have self-control is something that is characteristic of adolescents. People who don't have any self-control, the youth in the community. The elders are not people that we see running around sleeping with women. The elders are people who are more reserved, have more understanding, have more self-control. So the concentration here is on the youth of the community, not the elders. And the hadith has a story behind it. It was mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari on the authority of Al-Qamah, who was one of the top students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. قَالَ كُنْتُ عِنْدَ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بِنِ سُودِ فَلَّقِيَهُ عُثْمَانِ بِمِنَا فَقَالَ يَا أَبَا عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ إِنَّ لِي إِلَيْكَ حَاجَةً فَخَلِيَ فَقَالَ عُثْمَانِ هَلْ لَكَ يَا أَبَا عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ فِي أَنْ نُزَوِّجُكَ بِكْرَةً تُذَكِّرُكَ مَا كُنْتَ تَعْهَدْ فَلَمَا رَأَى عَبْدُ اللَّهِ أَنَّ لَيْسَ لَهُ حَاجَةً لِأَنَّهُ كَانَ كَبِيرَ السِّنِّ ليس له حاجة إلى هذا أشار إلي يعني علقمة فقال يا علقمة فانتهيت إليه وهو يقول أما لئن كنت ذلك لقد قال لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لما كنا صغار قال لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا معشر الشباب من استطاع منكم الباءة فليتزوج. علقمة, one of the top students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said that I was on Hajj with Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And we met Uthman ibn Affan, who was the Khalifa at the time. When he saw Abdullah ibn Mas'ud dressed in raggedy clothes, it was an indication that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud wasn't married. Uthman was a man of wealth, a man of prestige, a man that was shy, so shy the Prophet said, Ala astahi, mimman yastahi minhu al malaika, should not be shy in front of someone who even the angels are shy in front of him. But when you look at a man of that demeanor, that man of that type of caliber, this is a man who takes care of himself, is okay with what he, you know, is concerns himself with the way that he looks. So when he saw Abdullah ibn Mas'ud dressed in a raggedy clothing, he assumed that he wasn't married. He didn't have a woman in his life. So when he saw Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, I need to speak to you in private. He said to him in private, why don't we marry you to a young girl so she can remind you of your youthful days? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, I'm an old man, I have no desire for woman. He said, but I tell you what. And he called Al-Qamah, one of his students, who was a young boy at the time. He said, and if you are in the habit of encouraging marriage, he said, the Prophet used to say to us when we were kids, whoever from amongst you has the ability to get married, then let him do so. So you can see the Prophet was very diligent with the youth in his community to protect them and protect their deen. As opposed to what we do today, we're so concerned with your degree and how many letters you have before behind your name, and we could care less about the condition of your deen. And that is not to downplay secular education, I'm all for that. But not at the expense of your deen. There's nothing that deserves that type of preference. The deen comes first. And the moment we understand that bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we can begin to prioritize in a manner where our children don't compromise or jeopardize their integrity, their religious integrity, and their moral compass. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a'lam. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-azim. Wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bima ja'a fihi min al-ayati wa dhikri al-hakim. Aqulu ma tasma'un. Astaghfirullaha li wa lakum wa li sa'ir al-mu'minin min kulli dhanb. Fastaghfiruhu innahu huwa al-ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله العلي الجبار
غافر الذنب وقابل التوب الشديد العقاب وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله.
We don't expect the seniors, the elders in the community to understand the urgency of marriage with many of the youth. I don't expect you to understand that. Because when you get older, you begin to look at life through your own personal lens, as opposed to the lens that the youth in the community look at life. They have an urgency when it comes to marriage, whereas a person who's older, been married for a while, it's not urgent. And we begin to give advice to our children and the youth in the community like, be patient. Brothers and sisters, being patient, that type of advice is applicable to someone who has been accustomed to being told or being accustomed to being patient. You can't tell a child who you have literally satisfied every impulse of this child throughout his whole life. He's never had to be patient for anything. The latest sneakers, the latest technology, the latest phone. Some of our 10, 11, 12-year-olds have iPhones. Some of our 6-year-olds have iPads. They never had to be patient for anything. But then when they're ready to get married, we say, be patient. That's a language, that's a foreign language. They don't even understand what you're saying. They've never had to be patient for anything. If you want to encourage someone to be patient, then you have to set the precedence for them to acclimate themselves to that type of advice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran,
وَأَنفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and spend in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and don't let your own hands be the cause of your own destruction.
لَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ.
Don't let your own hands be the cause of your own destruction. So we have to ask ourselves as parents, as adults in the community, are we creating a trend amongst our children in the community that is going to come back and haunt us? Are we creating a trend with making marriage so taboo in our communities that our children go after the degrees, but they gain some other things in the process of that? And it only comes back to haunt us in the long run. And I don't even want to begin talking about the dangers of zina. Some of the things that happen to the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he commits zina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the servant, إِذَا زَنَا الْعَيْدِ, when the servant commits zina. And let me be clear about what zina is. Zina is to sleep with a woman that is not your wife. That is fornication. The punishment of which in the Quran is to be lashed 100 times. Zina is also applied to another word, which is called adultery. And that is to be married and sleep with someone that is not your wife, or you were married before, but you're not married at the time that you sleep with someone that is not your wife, or vice versa. And this is something that has become prevalent in the Islamic communities. I'm addressing you here today, but this is something that is specific globally, where you have some parents that even encourage their children to maintain monogamous boyfriend and girlfriend relationships. How do you do that to your children? How do you tell your daughter it's okay to have a boyfriend? How do you tell your son it's okay to have a girlfriend? Prevention is the best method. We don't follow the method of the kuffar, where they say, go ahead and do it. Look, but don't touch. Touch, but don't engage. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, well, that taqra bu zina. Don't come close to zina. The Prophet ﷺ said, zina al-ayn, another. The zina of the eyes is to look. Wa zina al-lisan and the takallam. And the zina of the tongue is to talk. The zina of the hands is to touch. The zina of the feet is to walk. Wa faraju sadiquhu wa yukadibuhu. And your private part will either fulfill all of that or reject all of that. Our issue with respect to this should be prevention is the best method. And we work diligently to make sure that when our children are actually ready, we prepare them for marriage. We don't let them become 18, 19, 20. We've never said a word to them about marriage in a home. And then when the conversation is brought up, we shoot them down and say, oh, you're not ready for marriage. I'm not ready for marriage because you didn't prepare me for marriage. Here again, don't let your own hands be the cause of your own destruction. There has to be preparation, brothers and sisters. In masajids, there need to be committees, marriage committees, that are responsible for educating the youth, the boys as well as the girls, as early as 13, 14, 15 years old, even if they're not getting married at that age. Obviously, we're not marrying them off at that age, but at least preparing them, at least giving them the Islamic guidelines. Sisters committee taking care of the women, men's committee taking care of the men, in the form of counseling, committees, workshops, seminars, all dedicated or designed to educate the children about marriage. Educate them to the dangers of zina. The dangers of zina are far beyond just the physical of AIDS or herpes or any other STD. But it also impacts your iman. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, إِذَا زَنَى الْعَبْدُ رُفِعَ إِيمَانُهُ كَالسَّحَابِ. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when a servant commits zina, his iman is lifted from him like a cloud over his head. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned in another hadith, لَا يُؤْمِنُ الْمُؤْمِنُ حِينَ يَزْنِي. لَا يَزْنِي الْمُؤْمِنُ وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنُ. That the believer does not commit zina except at the time he's doing it, he's not a believer. And that doesn't mean that he's a kafir. That just means that he's a believer with weak faith, weak iman. I don't know, for some people they're okay with that. I'm okay with having weak faith. It's not a big deal. But weak faith, it leads to other things. As the scholars, they say, أَنْتُمْ تَخَافُونَ الذُّنُوبَ وَنَحْنُ نَخَافُ الْكُفْرَ لِأَنَّ الذُّنُوبَ بَرِيدَةٌ لِلْكُفْرِ. The scholars, they say, you fear sin, but we fear kufr, because sins are a gateway to kufr. Sins open the door to kufr, to disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our job with respect to our children, brothers and sisters, is not to hold them by the hand and walk them through life. It's to equip them so they can stand on their own 2 feet and make sound decisions. Listen to Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, who was raised in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He describes his interaction with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قال Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, لقد خدمت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 10 سنين فوالله ما قال لي أف ولم يكن لشيء فعلته لما فعلت كذا ولا لشيء لم أفعل ألا فعلت كذا. رواه مسلم. أنس بن مالك رحمه الله رضي الله عنه, he said, I was in the service of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم for 10 years and he never once said to me أف. He never once disapproved of anything that I did. Good, bad, or indifferent. Because that's our job as parents. Our job is not to hover over you to make sure you do everything right in life. Simply because some of the mistakes our children make in life is part of the experience that is going to make them who they are. They have to make mistakes. How do you expect them to become who they are to become if they don't make mistakes? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا يلدغ مؤمن في جحر مرتين. He said, the believer doesn't get stung in the same hole twice. It doesn't mean that the believer will never get stung. It doesn't mean that he will never make a mistake. It means that he learns from his mistakes. He learns from his mistakes. But if we hovering over our children to make sure they never make a mistake in life, then basically what we're trying to do is create a replica of ourselves. And as the saying goes, when two people are the same, one of you are irrelevant. The world doesn't need another you. Stop trying to make your children be like you. Stop stealing from them their individuality. We put parameters around them, and we encourage them to stay within those parameters. Because without law, there's no order. That's just the way that it goes. But if our children decide to step outside of that, we have to teach them that there will be consequences. By giving them consequences when they are in our homes, and when they leave out of our homes, they understand the concept of consequence. Before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and within the society that we live in. And it's one of the he said that I serviced the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 10 years, and he never once said to me, oof. He never disapproved of anything that I did. He never said to me, for something that I did, why did you do that? Or for something that I didn't do, why didn't you do this? And we find ourselves doing that to our children all the time. Why didn't you go enroll in this college? Why didn't you take this course? Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? Why didn't you wait? Why didn't you do this? Because I didn't want to. This is my life. Let me make the decisions that I need to make. Your job as my parent is to help guide me along, not to make the decisions for me. When do you expect me to become an adult? We respect our children. We, with respect to our children, our recourse should be to be exemplary role models for them. To be role models for them. Many of us, especially you older brothers and sisters, you got married when you was young. And your parents helped you out. Or you made it through however you and your wife made it. You made it work. Why would it be any different for our children? Why do we want to lay out the white carpet and make sure everything is perfect before they get married? And in some instances, we make the women wait, in some countries, they make the women wait so long that by the time she gets married, she's beyond the age of having children. How oppressive is that? You keep telling a woman, wait, it's been, be patient, until the woman is 33, 34, 35 years old. And finally, you find the right, perfect match for her. And by that time, she can't even produce children. Brothers and sisters, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our job is to be role models. When some of the Sahaba said, three of them, one of them said, Asumu wala ufti. Wa qala thani, Aqumu al-layl wala anam. Wa qala thalith, la atazawwaj. Abadan. Lama sami'a an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hadha, ihmarra wajhu, wa ghadiba, wa ja'a ila thalatha wa qala antum alladhina qultum kadha wa kadha. He said, Wallahi inni asumu wa uftir. Wa akumu wa anam. Wa atazawwaju, he said. Faman raqiba an sunnati falaysa minni. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, three individuals, youth from the community, and their lack of understanding. One of them said, I will pray all night and I will never go to sleep. The other one said, I will fast all day and I will never break my fast. The other one said, I will never get married. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his face became red. And he found those three and he said, are you the three that said such and such? He said, I pray at night and I sleep part of the night. I fast and some days I break my fast. He said, and I marry women. He said, so whoever turns away from my sunnah, then he is not from me. رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه ولا تجعله ملتبسا علينا فنضل اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وأقيموا الصلاة.